Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Uncensored CMO. Now, one of my favourite adverts of recent times is the new one from McDonald's. I don't know if you've seen it yet. Raise your arches. There's me attempting to do arch raising for anyone on YouTube. So sorry if you're listening on audio, you might have missed that. But anyway, I'm meeting up in this episode with Chaka Sobhani, who is the Global Chief Creative Officer for Leo Burnett, who made the ad. She's one of the absolute legends of our industry. She's so creative and has got so much passion, not just for creativity, but also diversity inclusion as well. So in this episode, I'm catching up with Chaka to get her advice on how to be creative, how to make great work. We get into the craft of the ad as well and why it's been such a success. And we also talk about the state of diversity and inclusion in our industry. She, as a kind of prominent mixed race lesbian as well, has got a good point of view and a good perspective on it that I think we can all learn from. So without further ado, here's my conversation with Chaka. Chaka Sobhani, welcome to the show.
Hello, darling. How are you? You all right?
It's lovely to see you. How are you?
I'm very well. As I said to you a little earlier, I'm coughing a lot, so I'm so sorry. I'm just getting over this bloody cold. But apart from that, I'm all good. I'm very happy to be here happy to have a chat.
Well, let's start with congratulations. So Campaign just nominated you Creative Leader of the Year.
I know, that was very nice.
That's nice, isn't it?
It was very, very lovely. It was a very lovely surprise on all fronts, genuinely. We went along as a crew. We thought we were going to have a lovely evening. We had some of our clients down there. Obviously, you see lots of your pals and all the rest of it. And we're having a few drinks, but we thought it'd be nice that we're in the running. That's very cool, all the rest of it. Certainly not assumptive in any shape or form. And then it got to Strategy Leader of the Year and Joshy's name was announced and we were like, and then we went a bit crazy. And then about 5 minutes later, my name got announced and we were like, what the hell is going on? And then when they said agency year, that was the one.
Oh, that's everyone, isn't it? That's lovely.
Yeah, that's the one that means the most. It's very, very lovely to have it individually. Don't get me wrong. It's lovely. But actually the one that, that has proper meaning to it is because this is a crew effort. We've been busting it up for a long time. So to get sort of a recognition of that was really, really lovely. And the agency was buzzing. Our party was amazing and lots of sore heads and lost shoes and God knows what else. But no, it's very cool. It's really, really lovely.
Well, I can't wait to talk to you about McDonald's campaign, obviously, that's really kind of present at the moment. But before we do, tell us where it all started for you. Why advertising? How did you get into the industry in the first place?
It'd be great if I had a real plan and I could tell you a real story, like I'd hatched it out. I didn't at all. And I never have had, to be completely honest. And I've been very, very lucky and sort of I've worked bloody hard as well. But I personally, in my experience, the best things have happened to me without having a plan. Again, without necessarily overthinking it, what I realise, if I can be grand enough or probably old enough now to look back at my career and look at why certain things have happened, is I've always been driven by or have followed really amazing people and interesting people. So if I meet someone, not necessarily followed, but like I meet someone, if I'm lucky enough that they'll give me a job, I love being in awe of the people that I work with and that I'm going to learn a lot from. And I've had some incredible, incredible masters and mistresses. So that's sort of been my North Star, do you know what I mean? Without even knowing it, I've met people, like, oh my God, you're fucking amazing. Versus sort of like, oh, that's a really cool brand or organisation or whatever. So the aim was never advertising. I didn't even know really advertising existed. I mean, I knew obviously advertising existed, but I didn't know it was an industry or anything. I was just obsessed with films. And the only thing I knew that I wanted to be was a director, but only really because it was the only title I could really understand. You know, when you're looking at the credits and all the rest of it, and this is before the internet as we know it now, so you couldn't really go and research stuff in the same way. And if you did, I used to go to the BFI down on Stephen Street off Tottenham Court Road. And even there, like production companies and da, 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 and you'd look through stuff and I'd be like, I'm like, what the fuck is a gaffer and a director of photography? Sorry if I swear, by the way, I swear like a sailor. You know, all of that sort of stuff. I didn't really know what it meant. And so I was lucky enough to find a course that was like 50% practical and 50% theory. And all I knew was I wanted to direct. I didn't even know what. I had no bloody clue. And I started off, as a director. No contacts, no nothing. Wrote my, 200 letters, got 200 rejections, made phone calls on my first ever shitty mobile that I got with coupons from Sainsbury's, thanks very much. The Dan call phone, soup's cool. And found it. There was a studio in South London, in Brixton, called The Boiler House that had been set up by these two amazing guys, Mikhail Geisler and Clive Howard. One was an art director, one was a special effects guy. and they had funding from Lambeth Council, and it was a 30 by 30 water gantry studio. So we did like stop motion, water effects, sort of like music video stuff, and pack shots for like commercials and stuff. And these boys just gave me my second sort of university, and they were so generous. They gave me Super 8, they got me out shooting. And then from that, I started doing really, really low budget. When I say low budget, I mean literally no budget. Music videos, that went up. And to give you the fast forwarded version, from that, I got into comedy, did some sketch shows, ended up at Fox, at a kids network, Fox Kids. And then at ITV, got hired at ITV to set up ITV Creative with David Pemsel, one of the most instrumental people sort of in my life and career, and who I adore to this day. And then from there, a big chunk of time there, then to Mother, and then to Leo's. So yeah, so that's the whistle stop tour of it. Otherwise, I'll bore you senseless with all the what's it called. But there's lots of adventures in every chapter.
That's fascinating. I mean, take me back to ITV as well. So you set up the in-house creative team, production team. What do you learn about kind of the art of making creative? Presumably on a bit of a budget as well.
I've heard this brilliant podcast with Chris Evans, and Chris Evans was talking to Claudia Winkleman. And they were talking about their days in the 90s on cable TV, you know, when like digital channels were first being set up. And they talked about it. They talked about how important it was to them because they were making. They were sometimes succeeding, sometimes failing. But they talked about it. Chris Evans talked about it like pilot hours. And I really dug that. And the thing that I am forever grateful for my temperament, my hopefully for anything that I've learned, was that directing and then television. So if I could be grand enough to sort of talk chapters, so directing is probably one chapter, then that merged into TV, but then TV and then advertising, is I had my most fruitful period of making. We made so much. And obviously when you go into advertising, it's literally like the handbrake comes on and you're like, holy shit. And if I'm honest, as a young creative, I think I would have really struggled in an agency because I think it's really important that you're making. I think it's really, really important. One, for your clients, but I think just for your own passion projects. So it was, oh my God, it was just one. I've always felt very, this might sound a bit mushy and sentimental, but I sort of don't care actually, because I mean it. I felt so lucky that I just was invited to the party. Every time I'd walk into that building to London Television Centre, down on the South Bank, I would get genuinely every day a little bristle of excitement and butterflies in my stomach. And I would go down to Artists Cafe, where all the studios were. I would smoke my cigarette. I would see the Loose Women cast and This Morning, and then the people who were coming in for Jonathan Ross. Obviously at the weekends it was Ant and Dare, it was Graham Norton was shot there. Have I Got News for You? My first couple of weeks I got to know all the chippy, like that was it for me. Was, yeah, great, you know, obviously all the management flaws and all the rest of it, but being in and around studios, and it just not just TV studios, we then go to, you know, Black Island, wherever the hell we were going, with Shepperton or Pinewood, like just the smell of those places, still to this day, it's like the biggest rush to my stomach. I'm the luckiest girl in the world to have had those experiences, but to still feel like that when I not just think about those memories, but every day I have pinch me moments all the time. So anyway, like I said, that sounds a bit gushy and a bit sentimental, but I learn. It was just, again, it was like another university, and every day I was learning something new. Yeah. I worked across all the genres, which is great for me because I don't like repetition of working on the same thing over and over again. That needs to be sort of, a mixture of different things that we're working on. And obviously at ITV works from everything from fact end to drama to sport, current affairs, you know, it's like the whole gambit, branding, design, production, copy, continuity. That was the whole kit and caboodle. And it was awesome. And it all worked in this sort of mad, chaotic way. And you always just had this incredible sense of the thing that you did, people gave a shit about in some shape or form. I used to love the fact that my grandmother and grandfather-in-law, going and seeing them, they lived in Leicestershire, like you were quiet. When Emmerdale and Coronation Street was on, like you literally didn't say, you didn't go and make a cup of tea, nothing. And I was literally just, I used to get drilled. Like, what's happening in this show? What's going on in that? What's going on in this? Blah, 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 blah. There was just a currency to it, above and beyond, like, just celebrities. And they're like, they're always the common question, like, what are Anthem Deck like? Lovely, of course, which they are, and they're gorgeous, and I worked with them for a long time. They're fabulous. So it was incredible, working with commissioners, working with talent, working with agents, working with all different types of creative people, showrunners, our directors, writers, designers, like I said. It was honestly the best bloody university, the best university. And I met some incredible people who are still firm from friends to this day. And yeah, lucky girl.
Well, talking about that, I did get a listener question from a Mr. Rupert Howe.
Ah, me old mucker.
He says, if you can make a brilliant production for £10,000 at ITV, why are you spending so much money now?
He's such a cheeky monkey. Do you know what? I saw this brilliant talk years ago, about 15, 16 years ago. It was Mike Figgis, the director. And it was a time when, maybe it was a little longer ago than that, actually, but it was the time when everyone was, the big debate in production was around HD and whether HD was going to take off. So you either shot on film and you were a film purist on 35mm and 16mm, or you shot on Digibeta, or worse still, SP Beta, which was like, oh, sacrosanct. And remember when you watched telly back in the day, like you could see the soaps were shot on like Digi, and then you'd look at films, oh, that's shot on very, very grand. And the very beginning of kind of HD cameras, I remember Sony would go around and do all these like demos and stuff, and they were trying to say, oh, you can shoot high speed, and it was like rubbish. And there was, anyway, the cameras weren't great at the time, at the very, very beginning. But like I said, there was this big raging debate of which one's better. And actually, I think this is a point. It's not about good or bad or better and worse. Mike Figgis talked about you choose your instrument depending on the story that you're trying to tell. So when he was directing Leaving Las Vegas, and he wanted that sense of the atmosphere of addiction and kind of falling, your life falling apart, and he needed that intimacy. He needed to shoot on 30mm. He needed that grittiness. He needed the depth of field, what he could do with the colours and the grade. And then when he was shooting something like Time Code, which was literally about four parallel stories, funnily enough, you know, when you've got a mag, a 100-foot mag on, that's only going to give you 10 minutes. You go to it and you shot it all on little PD-150s because the tapes were an hour and a half long. So he could shoot the entire film in one take. And that's the point. It's not about, oh, whether it's an idea is £10,000 or whether an idea is £2 million. What are you trying to achieve? And what's the end result? If you want pancakes, it costs a certain amount of money, and pancakes are fucking brilliant and delicious, amazing. You wouldn't need to go and spend £100,000 on some pancakes. Whereas if you want something fancy schmancy and the taste of caviar and the richness of this and the look of that, it's going to cost more money. If it's got talent involved, et cetera, et cetera. So it's not as, I love him because he's cheeky and he's trying to be controversial, little minx. It's not, I have no pleasure in just spending money for the sake of it. I like to think I'm very bloody responsible because I was brought up with no money and by a brilliant bloody mum who gave me an appreciation of the value of everything. And just because you've got it doesn't mean you need to go and spend it. But you have to be very honest about what you're trying to achieve in any field, whether it's obviously what we do, creativity and production and ideas, or whether it's finance or whatever the hell, whatever it is, everything has a price attached to it. And you have to be honest about that and what you're trying to get to, and, you know, not have champagne taste for beer money or the flip way around. And if money is a concern, there's always a way of being able to get to the... I refuse to believe that it's like, oh, well, money means something's brilliant and not having money means something's shit. Absolute rubbish. Absolute rubbish. The antithesis of creativity. But you have to be honest about what you're trying to achieve and what you need to get there.
Makes so much sense.
I'm not trying to be diplomatic. I genuinely...
No, you're absolutely right. It makes a lot of sense. So you went from ITV, where very hands-on, and now you're global chief creative officer for a big network agency.
Yeah.
How different does that feel in terms of the actual job? Because presumably you're not involved in as much of the craft and on the ground decision making as you're. See, yeah, talk to me about the role of what's a global chief creative officer role feel like?
I don't think there should be one definition of it. I think hopefully it's about how you turn up and what's important to you. Now, there's certain parts of the job which are sort of, they are different to when you are a pure maker. You are much more client facing. You're obviously, I'm massively involved in new biz and working in different markets as well. Obviously, I'm based in London, and the UK is still, I'm still the CCO for the UK as well, but obviously got markets around the world. So those aren't necessarily things that I was involved with as a maker, but me as a person, I sort of think about it like, it's like if you're a chef. I don't really think you can call yourself a chef if you don't still get into the kitchen. And not because you should, that's just who I am. I'd lose my mind. Oh my God, love, you know, I'd go crazy.
This is what I'm wondering. It's like, you know, surely you want to be also in the creative process, don't you?
100%. And I think the difference is so, and I would like to think that's sort of, like I said, it's sort of in your hands how much you do that and what's important to you. And it's massively important to me, hopefully to keep me fresh and keep me learning and learning from our young'uns who are coming up, working with brilliant partners. I still get a buzz of working with, you know, new directors or new designers or whoever it is, or whether they're young or old or people just I haven't worked with. That for me is the definition of creativity, is those butterflies you get in your stomach, because you see the electricity in the air and you're a part of it. And that's the beautiful thing about what we do. It's certainly the beautiful thing, particularly when you come from production, is you are a crew. Literally, it's all of you together. And that's where your strength comes from. I think one of the things, particularly as you get older, and it, probably a little bit of this is to do with obviously the change in your role and stuff, but it's really important to me to give people autonomy. I thrived the most when I was allowed to be responsible and make decisions and stand by those. So it's a fine balance, I think, of staying involved and hopefully being helpful. And also selfishly getting something out of it yourself, like I said, in the learning thing, but hopefully adding a little bit of a little 5% that might, you know, just with experience and stuff, yeah, might take things in certain different directions. But at the same time, I personally think you start feeling a bit of a shift as you get a bit older, in terms of my role is no longer about being in the spotlight myself. I think there's a period in your life, in your 20s and your early 30s, where it's about me, me, me. It's a massive part of my job now is to create, hopefully, the environment where people can be the best version of themselves creatively and just as human beings. It's not just about work, but also about opening doors and putting the spotlight on amazing talent that's coming. You know that feeling when you see someone and like they don't even know how good they are and they haven't even reached their peak? It's like a sportsman or a sportswoman and you're just like, holy shit, this is electric. And to be part of that, that's just... No, that's
so resonate with what you said there, actually, because I don't know whether it's an age thing, but I genuinely get more excitement from other people's success now. I genuinely feel so happy for them and kind of like, you know, and I think it's a weird thing, and maybe in my 40s or whatever, but that I can really resonate with that. It's so satisfying to see
people flourish. It probably has also some kind of correlation as well to sort of like, basing things like becoming a parent as well. Like, so again, like the shift becomes about the focus is on someone else. And you wanting them to do really well. And I'm not saying that's the same relationship as you have at work. It's not it's not infantilized like that. It's not a parent-child. But hopefully, I think that's a beautiful thing about life, is we have these different chapters and our rhythms are different. And it doesn't mean that we're any less or any more. We just bring a slightly different flavor to the table. So anyway.
Yeah, no, it makes a lot of sense. Now, talking of great creative work as well, I'm desperate to talk to you about the McDonald's campaign.
Yay! I could talk Maccas all day.
I'm sure. I know.
Love them.
And look... It really caught light, didn't it? I mean, look, again, sample of one, but it's by far the most read LinkedIn post I've ever done. When I shared the results of the campaign,
quarter of a million
people saw it.
Oh,
it's just like something, cool. There was something about it. And what I thought was fascinating is it's very unusual to have such industry acclaim and such kind of popular acclaim as well. Because sometimes in our industry, what excites us is the craft or the pushing boundaries, that sort of thing. And then you kind of look at what the audience like and they're often very different.
Yeah.
But in this case, it was very good. What was also great about it, I thought, and again, I'll show you some System One results in a minute, is it did long-term brand building and it did activation. It was one of those things that did both, right? Sell them the long-term dream and so on. The other thing I thought was amazing about it is, you were selling burgers with no burgers in sight.
Yeah, that
right?
wasn't bad, was it?
That's a trick, right? but talk to me about where did the brief come from? How did the idea come about? I'd love to find out a bit more about the idea.
So, and I am going to sound gushy now. I don't care about this at all. So I love McDonald's. I love McDonald's as a brand. Always have done as a kid. I worked at McDonald's when I was 16 years old. Had a very fetching uniform. Managed to get one star.
Did you get a star? Oh,
good. Got one star.
Well done.
Yeah. I only stayed for a summer. I think I was doing my A-levels. Yeah, so it was in between, like, college courses. But anyway, I've always obviously had a relationship with the brand. And then when I joined Leo's, was lucky enough to start working on the brand in the UK and then obviously globally as well. So that's sort of a given. The other part of it, which was, which I'd been told, and then obviously you have to experience yourself, as clients, it's always, it's such a strange word, clients, but obviously that's the official term for it. They're more than clients, they're my friends and they are people that I respect and I genuinely adore and love. They are brilliant human beings. They, just as human beings, first and foremost, then as marketeers, so they're a joy to work with because they understand their brand inside out and back to front. They understand the DNA of their brand from a values and sensibilities point of view, I think that's, you know, our relationship goes over 30 years. And there's a reason for that. It's because we share the same values and kind of like where we come from. So that's the foundation to, for any great work, I think, firstly. I don't think you can ever get to that without a proper relationship that is baked in trust and love and generosity. And we have that in bloody spades. And there's genuinely not a time, and I'm not saying this is some bloody thing, for, you know what I mean, to sound sucky. I don't care. They're just fucking great. So that's the starting point. So we've been on a journey, obviously, and through all the stuff that happens in culture and society, and there are moments when, you know, the brand is sort of more popular and not, all that kind of stuff. And I think particularly over the past sort of 4 or 5 years, we felt like we've been on a real trajectory with the brand and finding, I don't know, maybe a different gear for it and a different level of confidence, never braggadoce, but sort of always under the sort of the North Star of kind of being confidently humble. Anyway, so again, I don't think there are just moments where you just fall upon it. I think it's all kind of incremental and you kind of are building to these things without really knowing it. We have a very clear comms model and a strategy that we know inside out, back to front. This piece of work came out of the affinity pillar, the love pillar, which is always the trickiest one because it's around brand. So in one way, you kind of go, oh my God, we can do anything. And then on the other hand, you're like, oh shit, like what's the thing that we're going to talk about? We had a platform that we launched last year around fancy McDonald's. So just the truth about, you know, there's always moments in life. And I think when we are on point with the brand, we know where McDonald's sits in people's lives, which is never front and center. There's never the arrogance of that. We're always in support and in service. So all these amazing things happen in life. And every now and then, little Macca's coming in here and there. It's always lovely. All the different moments. It was always after swimming for me. Anyway, that's just as an aside. So we already had that platform and we were sort of on the second difficult album. And we had a great campaign that had gone out and had landed kind of the thought. And as always, I think with the best ideas, you can always do this in hindsight. You look at it and you go, why don't we come up with that? It's the most obvious, simple thing in the world. And it came from a very, very simple truth. The brief came from a very, very simple truth, which is an invitation to have a McDonald's is so ubiquitous and part of our behaviour and sort of culture that there's actually no need for words. There's a behaviour for it. There's a physical kind of little act that you do, which is this raising of the arches. And then the brilliant creative who came up, this guy called Gareth Butters, one of our creative directors, again, who makes it all look so simple. Then one, having had this thought off the brief, then realised obviously the raising of your arches very helpfully. What does it look like? Oh, it looks like the arches. And there it was, and it was born. And when you talk to him, and he's obviously far more eloquent on this because he really went into the bowels of this because he came up with the idea. He's really honest. He just goes, I would love to tell you it's torturous, but he said, just really simple. I just got to it, like read the inside, just went, right, that's what the idea is.
They're the best ones, though. They're the best ones. Aren't they? Just instinctively right.
100%. Yeah. And then to your point about craft, it's about all of those small elements, all the little elements in one, the script, so in that one piece of film that make the humour pop, you know, the partner that you, so he's a massive fan of Edgar Wright. We were lucky enough that he read the script straight away. You know, you got something great.
You could tell it was Edgar Wright as well. Just the way the scene unfolds and the choreography being all lined up was very him, wasn't it?
Yeah. The hook. Yeah. And that gives you massive confidence when you send it to a director like that and straight away they're like, yeah, we're interested. Like, oh, fantastic. That's made us kind of feel good about this. Then all the surround sound stuff. And then, yeah, and you said a really interesting thing. Obviously, the Holy Grail is it's great to have the praise of your peers, of course. But to be honest, like, the only thing we care about is audiences. I mean, that's it. That's all that matters. It's a lovely byproduct if your fellow gang kind of dig it, but that's not a reason to make
it. Well, I think I read a quote from you, which I love, which is, I love the industry, but I don't do it for them. No. And we have to remind ourselves of that, don't we? Which is why I kind of love this so much, because it got obviously critical acclaim amongst, you know, peer group and so on, but it worked very well, which I want to talk about the craft, because what I thought I'd do is show you the System One results here. We'll do this live, everybody. So if you're watching, you'll be able to see this, you know, live on video. If you're listening, you might be able to hear it as it play out. But there's a few craft points I wanted to ask you about, because there's some real, real mastery in this, in the execution, that I wanted to kind of talk through, which I think is brilliant. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Test Your Ad Pro Report. So we've picked office workers under the age of 35. Now, this was us sort of guessing, because, you know, that's kind of where the scene is set, sort of thing. So the reason I said it long and short is what we do with the test is we ask people how they feel, right? Because how you feel about it is more important than what you think, because, you know, it's not an exam question. This is about emotion, right? And it scores a very, very impressive 4-star, which puts it in the top 2 or 3% of all ads. So congratulations. What it also does is short term, what we call the spike rating, which is exceptional levels. So that is how likely are people to go out and buy as a result of it, which it also does. Now, this is quite unusual to be doing both things, which is brilliant. So firstly, congratulations. I'm just going to whiz through to the what we call the face trace. This is the emotion people feel as they're watching. Let me play this out. So hopefully everyone will remind, if you haven't seen it or you have seen it, and want to be reminded, here it is. What I love about this, there's so many little touches in there that really make this work. And I just wanted to point two or three little things out because for everyone listening and watching. The first thing is, what this does amazingly is, so what we see in the graph here is the green is happiness and the dark green is surprise.
That makes me feel
and
very good.
You just sustain and you feel it, don't you? Just yeah. It's unusual to get a sustained level of happiness because of the way the choreography is done, the music, the characters and so on. It's brilliant. Now, really fascinating thing here is that at the bottom, we've got the branding. So this is at what point do people understand it's McDonald's? The post-it note scene, right?
Is when it kicks in.
It almost like 80% of the audience, that's the moment.
Yeah.
And that's so interesting because this is back to my point about not showing burgers, right? Yeah. You did not need to show a burger for people to know what the brand was, what it stood for and so on. But a tiny little detail like the post-it note.
Yeah.
And even, you've actually got about 20% of the audience recognised it from what the woman in the first scene is wearing, the yellow and the red. Is that something you know? I mean, is that something you've understood or is it just the brand has become, you know, so familiar and iconic?
I would love us to be able to take all the credit for that, but I don't think we can. I think over the years and globally, obviously, McDonald's is, I've read something once that it's in the top three most iconic logos. I mean, and I don't mean brand logos. I mean, logos as in, I think there's sort of like the Christian cross is number one and then there was something else number two and then it was the McDonald's logo, which is just mind-blowing. And not surprising considering, obviously, the scale of the brand and I'm sure, again, with Coca Cola, certain brand, Nike, you know, the swoosh, etc. So I think, one, we've got the heritage of that, which is massively helpful and that it is so recognisable. But I don't... Things like, it's interesting when you say about, you know, the colours of people's clothing and stuff like that. I think there are certain things you consider and I think there are certain things you can overconsider as well. And I think sometimes it can be a mistake to overthink it and there has to be a purity to the story that you're telling. I don't really sound like a wanker, but there has to be an authenticity to the story that you're telling and that has to drive it. And then, of course, there are, ultimately, we're talking about a brand. We're coming from the point of view of the brand. We have to, there's certain things that need to land. The reason to put the post-it note in there was it wasn't for a branding point of view. It was really, really important that there was something natural that gave a cue as to why the invitation to a McDonald's. So you put the logo on a post-it note, you wouldn't have a bit of food around and then show like a bit of packaging. That would again,
look at my burger.
Exactly. Totally inauthentic. Yeah. Would have just absolutely ponged straight away of like, oh, they're trying to sell us something versus, no, this is just like, okay, the day's a bit like this. Actually, what would cheer it up a bit? Oh, lovely little trip to Macca's. Yeah. And then from that, then obviously everything else falls into place. But things like the cues of when you say about the clothes, I think that's just it's not like just a happy accident, but it's, you know, I think we've all seen certain brands can really over-index on that. And then, you know, like the colour of the brand is red and everyone is wearing red. And it's like, people aren't stupid. You just, the suspension of disbelief just falls to the wayside and people just know they're being sold to. And the minute you do that, like, it's just off-putting. Whereas I think if you turn up in the most generous and true and authentic way, what's the role of McDonald's in our lives? Hopefully to sort of just give a little moment of feel good, a tiny little moment of feel good every now and then. So if you stay there and in the right place and have the right level of humility and confidence and you tell your stories with that lens of authenticity, then I think people will come along the ride. And that graph is amazing. I don't think I was going to say that about a graph, but, you know, ultimately you said exactly the right thing. You know, we create work, and the only thing that we can gauge it by is feelings. We're trying to create a feeling and we want people to react to it in some way. And ultimately, with the brands we work with, and particularly with McDonald's, the reaction is happiness and joy.
What's lovely about this, I think part of the reason for that graph is that you've got this scene unfolding that just builds and builds and builds. So your attention's caught very early on, and then you just want to follow it through. And the glances between people and the walking past the meetings. And the casting's brilliant. The acting's brilliant. And it's the way the scene unfolds. And then you overlay the music, which just, you know, gets you. I mean, music is so powerful, isn't it? And that just, you know, perfectly complements the whole action as it unfolds.
100%. And obviously, as we said, like when you have the mastery of someone like Edgar Wright, who every frame is considered and all the performances are on point. The casting is amazing. Eyebrow casting. I mean, who the hell would have thought that that would be a part of your day today? That's what I love about what we do. But there's not a frame wasted.
Do you actually have a eyebrow raise casting? Like,
well, yeah, I mean, that was obviously pivotal. If you can't raise your... Some people can't do it, by the way.
A bit too much Botox. Or
no, not that. I can't raise my eyebrows that high. I haven't had any Botox, but it's not very dramatic.
Yeah.
It's quite boring the way I do it. The main lady with the red hair, she's got the most killer eyebrows I've ever seen, like the most expressive things ever. And then my personal favorite part is the guy with the mop. It always makes me giggle with his little gladiatorial scream up to the skies.
That was his moment, wasn't it?
It's the most crazy thing in the world.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm glad that people dug it so much.
Did people start copying? Because it's a very good, obviously Mackie D's is kind of a cultural thing, isn't it? Yeah. Have people picked this up as a eyebrow raise in social media and stuff like that?
All you need to do is type in raise your arches McDonald's into TikTok. Yeah. And there are thousands, And this is the thing again, it's like, when there's an idea that you're not crowbarring down people's throats, they just want to pick up on it and want to have a bit of a laugh with it. So one of the best things that you see is there's loads of crew members who've done it in their restaurants, and they've put something together with like their pals, and they're walking around the restaurant and they're doing the raised eyebrows and stuff like that. But there's just loads and loads of customers who have put on all the filters. They're daft, they're really exaggerated and stuff. It's just a lot of laugh. It's just, you know what I mean? It's just a bit of shits and giggles for the fun of it. And that's what we're about.
And it's kind of weird, sense, back to our friend Rupert. It kind of feels a bit Tango-esque, doesn't it? The whole slap kind of thing, in a weird sense of creating a...
Oh, don't give him another reason Tango. No, I'm joking. It's an incredible piece of work. So, yeah, I mean, if we ever get close to something as classic as that, then we'll be very, very happy. Yeah, yeah, man, absolutely.
And is this a one-off, or are you planning more... eyebrow raising, arch raising?
No, it's not a one-off. That would be, I think, a bit of lunacy if we hit on something like this and thought that this was the only way we could have fun with it. As always, I think when you're thinking about the next step, you can't overthink it, because you can get sort of stuck in, oh, is it going to be as good? Is it going to be this? Is it going to be that? Right to the clarity and the purity of the idea and the insight, and I think we'll be good. So I've actually seen the work. Yes, it's very exciting. And fingers crossed, we will be making the next part of this in the next couple of months.
Oh, yeah. You're teasing us now. Yeah, you're teasing us.
I can't say anything. Yeah, but it's going to be good. Well, I hope. Anyway, we'll do our best.
That's very exciting. Well, ladies and gentlemen, watch this space, see what comes. But it's brilliant. Amazing. I wanted just to pivot a little bit and talk a little bit about diversity in the industry as well, because I know you're very passionate on it. And we've collaborated a few times on the Feeling Seen project with ITV and Wise Up, looking at older demographics. What's your take on how much the industry's done in this space and how much it's got to do?
So unsurprisingly, there's still shitloads to do. I don't think that's just about advertising. I think pretty much all major industries have still got a long way to go. I'm sure but I really hope the same conversations are happening in finance. I hope they're happening in industry, et cetera, et cetera. There's a long way to go. And there's on a really basic, so before looking at the statistics, which are still obviously fucking woeful, let's be really, really clear. Like, we can't mince our words about this. I've got a 13-year-old and an 11-year-old daughter. And when they were born, I remember... definitely very naively thinking they were going to, in 20 years' time, enter a very different workforce than the one that I had entered. And very slowly, I've had the realization that it's not actually going to be that different. It's different in a number of ways and really good positive changes, but it's not, we are going to experience very similar experiences as mothers and daughters. And I really didn't want them to have certain experiences. And the fact, for me personally, as a brown queer woman, when I still look around and try and see my representation, I see barely anyone. I do think advertising is behind the rest of the creative industries that I've worked in. And I'm not saying for one second that television and production have nailed it. Not at all. There's still massive discrepancies in terms of ageism, what people are earning by gender, in front of the camera, behind the camera, all of that stuff, 100%. But in my humble opinion, when I came into advertising a lot later, as you said, only 10 years ago, and I was really shocked, really, really shocked at just what I saw. So forget, again, the statistics, just walking around the hallways and who you see and what you see is just not reflective of my world, or it's not reflective of the world that we live in. And if we want to make work, we talk about authenticity a lot. If we want all the best work is authentic and it is written to reflect stories that are written by people who fucking experience those stories. I do not need to have love told to me by one group of society and it being usually privileged and white and male. I love white males, even if they have privilege, but it's not the only voice I want to hear. I want to hear all of the voices. If we just rely on grassroots, it is going to take forever. So it takes more effort and more time. I do not have the answers. I am so desperate and need the brains of much cleverer people than me, because I know that when we all get together, we'll do things a lot faster. And I know this is a bit, it's not a strange thing to say, I don't think. The pandemic, as horrific as it was, showed that in the face of the biggest tragedies and the worst times, what this incredible human race can do when it needs to. So I can't buy the fact that, oh, it's going to take another decade or two decades. Yeah. Fuck right off, not you, sir. But anyone who says that, it's rubbish. But it for it to change at the rate that we need it to, it needs to be of the same importance, literally the same importance in our bones, in our DNA, as new business, as the survival of our businesses, because it is actually imperative to the survival of our businesses. When advertising or communications or marketing feels inauthentic, what do you think that is? It's not about, oh, we're not going in these channels, we don't know how to gravitate towards Gen Z. Because you're not reflective of that bloody audience. You're not telling those stories. You're not, it doesn't come from the heart and it doesn't come from the head of, and we're not learning. Anyway, I could rant on about it forever. I try to stay optimistic. I can get really frustrated, and then I get frustrated myself because I feel like I should be doing more. Like I said, I don't have the answers. I do know that if it's genuinely as important for all of us, genuinely, and I appreciate that it's difficult for it to be as important if your footprint is the main footprint of the world and that you walk through the world quite easily and you don't know what it's like not to walk through the world as easily, and that's the case for a lot of us. I get it, but it's not an excuse.
I think that's why at kind of system when we did the Feeling Seen report, actually, was just to show people that it isn't the risk that they might feel it is. That actually, you know, telling one person's story, I mean, this is one of the profound insights I've really struck me when we're doing the research, is that if you tell one person's story really well, it's not like you're leaving everyone else out, because the whole power of storytelling and advertising is you see into someone else's world. And that's really powerful. And so, you know, I mean, I remember I was working with Addie Rawcliffe over at ITV, and we sat down together, and we were looking at an iCad, and it had a black pregnant woman in it. And she was quite emotional, going, I don't think I've seen a black pregnant woman in an ad before, not one as, powerful and as emotive as that. And I tingles down my spine as well. So it's not as if, when it's done well, you know, great diverse advertising is not a divisive thing. Actually, we ended up with the kind of, you know, how diverse advertising unites us, yeah, kind of thing. Because absolutely, actually, done well, this is where you need to sort of get off social media a bit, because, yeah, you know, you can really get the wrong idea. But we certainly tried with Feeling Seen to give people the case. You shouldn't need to do that. I know you shouldn't need to do the case for it. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? We should be beyond that point. But what we're trying to do is just go, look, it's the right thing to do, but also it's the effective thing to do. And when people realise, we it's a bit cheap, we call it diversity dividend, but what you see is the audience reflected. You saw this happiness on your McDonald's ad. What you see is more happiness. And what's interesting is actually when we go behind the numbers, it's everyone feels the same, like the story arc will be the same for everybody. But when you're represented, you feel the intensity of the emotions greater. And that's really powerful. You can just see the emotion more intense. So, for me, and what we tried to do with the report, and like we're Wise Up looking at older generations as well, is just showcase that work and give people the, well, first is the confidence, but secondly, just to go, look, it can be done. Yeah. So I'm hoping, I know there's lots to be done, but I'm hoping slowly, but, and what I'm also hoping is we start to hero some of those members of society. I mean, we did a session with ITV looking at disability. I can't tell you, I was humbled. I mean, I know it sounds a bit, but what I realized in that moment is, oh my God, if anyone has got a challenge, like just listening to, you know, disabled people talking about their day or how they get to a meeting or how they, you know, yeah. I was just, oh my God, if I think I've got any problems in fact, I'd had a car accident, not a sort of bike accident, actually at Christmas, and I was a bit limited in my movement at the time. So I thought, I'm not even going to mention it. You know what I mean? Because just listening to what they go through. And then I thought about advertising and thought, I can name on one hand, right, the number of times I've seen an advert with a disabled person in it. Mm. You know, there are a few, I mean, Maltesers do actually did a great job about 3 years ago on it. But, you know, I think there are some groups there that we need to elevate and need to kind of, you know.
Yeah, 100%. But, I mean, it's, I know you weren't saying it for that reason, but, you know, it's tragic that we can name one or two campaigns. Yeah. More importantly, who are the people that you work with and have work in advertising who are from those communities? Mm. So it's not about blame and it's not about making people feel bad. But like I said, unless this becomes truly the priority for all of us, allies, people who are from those minority groups, and we come up hopefully with some different solutions. I don't know what they are necessarily. We do need to do more. And of course, as you said, it makes business sense. But we talk a lot about we want to impact culture and, you know, we have a conscience. Well, stop fucking talking about it and do something about it. You know what I mean? Yeah. And as I said, it has to come from the heart. This stuff has to be important to you for the right reasons. And it is for the majority of people. I just, yeah. Every single put, you know, the idea that these stories are all so different. Of course they are. There are massive nuances in our experiences, of course. But at the end of the day, we are all human beings. We want to be seen. We want to be heard. And we want to have a sense of belonging. And if we can, in any shape or form, make people feel represented and seen and heard and increase empathy and understanding for other people's stories. So that's not a bad thing that we can do within what we do as an industry. That has to be a fucking good thing. And we can do it. It's all in our hands. And we start talking about, oh, it means we're politicizing stuff. We're not fucking politicizing anything at all. You know, queer stories are not politicized. They don't all have to be about coming out. The biggest goal for me is when there isn't a need for a bloody label and I don't have to say I'm queer or whatever the hell I am. Well, that nobody does. And anyway, I could hang on about it.
Chaka, I think that is the perfect peak end, actually. And I think, congratulations, by the way, on McDonald's work. And the power, I mean, we talk about changing culture, right? But, you know, what you've done with McDonald's work certainly does that. So hopefully a lot more to come. And thank you for coming on the show and sharing your story.
Thanks, man. Sorry for coughing all over the place. I hope none of you go down with this thing. If you do, I apologise and I'll send you some lockets.
Brilliant. Thank you so much.
Thanks, darling.
Thank you, everyone, for listening to The Uncensored CMO. I hope you enjoyed it. If you'd like to listen or watch more episodes like this, please do subscribe. You can do that wherever you get your podcasts. If you'd like to check out my YouTube channel, head over to Uncensored CMO over on YouTube. And if you'd like to leave me a review, please do, remembering that 5 is the score to go for. But thank you for following. And if you want to contact me, I'm over on LinkedIn at John Evans or on Twitter at Uncensored CMO. See you next time.